I am very much happy to meet you all here in this good occasion. Now we are going to think about what is enlightenment. Is there any possibility to reach enlightenment in an easy way? Because it is considered a mystical one. Nobody is having a clear idea about what is enlightenment. There are many schools of thought describing what is enlightenment, what is liberation. There are many statements are there. So now we are going to inquire what is the details of the enlightenment and the possibilities of enlightenment. Is it simple or complicated? But in my own case, I have tried it for several years. Around 40 years, I have tried here and there. After the end of 40 years, I came across the state of enlightenment. When I got what is enlightenment, then I was surprised. How simple it is. So I wonder, is it necessary to waste the entire 40 years to find out this simple fact? But it is like this. It is eluding here and there. So it gives me an urge to share my finding. Because everybody was, wherever I go, wherever I saw, everybody is going here and there in search of enlightenment. Because there is no definite idea, there is no definite stand with related to enlightenment. So, without knowing what is enlightenment, everybody is searching. They do not know what is enlightenment. Without knowing anything, they are searching. But how can they find out if there is no idea about enlightenment, how can they find out? How can they verify whether we have find out correct or not? Without knowing anything, we are searching. For example, if I ask you a question, do you know the quality of your milk? And you will say, I give you a tumbler of milk. And you will say, yes, I will say you the quality of milk, and I will taste the milk, and I will taste how it tastes. And you drink the milk and taste the milk, and then you say, oh, I know this is milk. This will be the quality of the milk. You can say. But at the same time, from one bottle is there. Just like here, one bottle of milk is there. And here, one bottle of water is there. If I ask a question, which one is water and which one is milk? Can you say, I have to drink, then only I will say which one is water and which one is milk? Not necessary. The very apparent look itself shows, this is milk and this is water. You need not taste anything. Without tasting, very, very apparent look itself shows you, this is milk, this is water. Because on the very appearance itself, we can distinguish what is water and what is milk. You need not feel, you need not taste it. So here, if we know what enlightenment is, you need not taste the enlightenment. If you understand in your intellectual way, from intellectual understanding, intellectual perception of what is enlightenment, then you are enlightened. The very understanding, very intellectual understanding of what enlightenment is, itself give you an enlightenment. So you need not taste enlightenment. You need not feel enlightenment. So everybody is having the confusion that we have to feel enlightenment. We have to enjoy enlightenment. Enlightenment has nothing to do with that. There is no necessity to enjoy it. There is no necessity to feel enlightenment. So mere verbal understanding, mere intellectual understanding is enough. If you understand what is enlightenment, what is not enlightenment, if you understand the verbal understanding, the intellectual understanding is enough. So, but we are having some mistaken idea, some mystical idea about enlightenment, and we are expecting many things in the name of enlightenment. But it is very simple. It is here and now. Anybody can be enlightened within a second. But in the olden days, it was told in the history, in the story of the Jamaka and the Astrograha. Astrograha, you might have heard the Astrograha Gita, and Jamaka, the king of Jamaka. The Jamaka is a king. When he gone through a scripture, and in the scripture it is said, one can get the enlightenment within seconds. One can get the enlightenment if anybody mounting on a horse, putting one leg on the one part of the saddle and putting the other leg on the other part of the saddle, within the meantime, he can get the enlightenment. So, it is very easy. Anybody can be enlightened within seconds. So, it is said like that. So, am I good to understand? Because many practices are going, many saints are doing many practices, many yogis are there doing entire, they are devoting their entire life for the practice of yoga, meditation and enlightenment. Then, but if they say it can be got within seconds, within a span of time, before mounting a horse, then how is it possible? He can unable to understand. So he asked the teacher, he asked the Vedanta teacher, please give me enlightenment within seconds, as he told in these scriptures. But the pandits who taught the scriptures to the king Janaka, he expressed that I have not myself been enlightened, then I cannot give you enlightenment. So you have to find out some other person to get such kind of enlightenment. So King Janaka searched many persons to give such kind of enlightenment. And whoever he found out, whoever he asked, everybody declined, I am unable to give you such kind of enlightenment within seconds. You have to practice in many ways, you have to work on many ways. Everybody invariably says all those same thing. But at last, the Astrograha came. And he assured that I can give you enlightenment within seconds. You can get enlightenment before mounting a horse by putting one leg on the one part of the saddle and putting the other leg on the other saddle, in the meantime, you can get enlightenment. But the King Janaka is very much interested, and he asked, please teach me and give me enlightenment within seconds. But the Astrograha asked a question to the King Janaka, now are you a king now to get enlightenment, or you become ready to be a disciple for me at this time? Are you ready to be a disciple of me, or you are interested to continue as a king? But the King Janaka was interested upon the enlightenment, so he proposed that I am ready to be a disciple of yourself. Then Astrograha asked him to follow him. And they both went into a forest. And they also bring a horse. Because the specification is that you have to put one leg on the saddle of a horse and he have to put the other leg on the other side of the saddle. Then in the meantime he have to give enlightenment. So they have taken a horse along with them. They reach in the forest. And Ashoka asked him, "Are you ready to accept what I am is told? What I will tell you, are you ready to accept?" And Janaka also accepted that I am ready to follow what you are telling. So now you put one of your legs on the saddle, in the first part of the saddle. And King Janaka himself put one leg on one part of the saddle. And he has to put the other leg on the other part of the saddle. So at that time, the Ashoka disappeared. See, he placed him to put one leg on the one part of the saddle, but he has to put the other leg on the other part of the saddle. In the meantime, he has to give enlightenment. But after putting the one leg on the first saddle, the Ashoka disappeared. Then what has to do? King Janaka, what has to do? So, in that time, he got enlightened. So, this is the mystery. This is the secret. How he got enlightenment. So, now I am going to explain what has happened to Janaka. But you may come across the story of Janaka and Ashoka, but they have not properly explained the details of enlightenment. They may easily told the story, but they did not reveal the secret behind the story. What is the meaning of the story? They may simply say the Ashoka Gita, but the Ashoka Gita is after the enlightenment of Janaka. It is not, the Janaka has not got the enlightenment with the help of the Ashoka Gita. Ashoka Gita has happened only after the enlightenment of Janaka. That is after later aspect of the enlightenment. But Janaka did not get enlightenment only because of Ashoka Gita. That is a later aspect. But the enlightenment happened even before Ashoka Gita. So, we have to understand what has happened to the Janaka at the time of getting enlightenment. So, that is the secret of enlightenment. So, here, what is enlightenment? But here, why we are trying to get enlightenment? The first of all, we seek enlightenment. Why we are seeking enlightenment? And there is some musician in Chennai, and he is a famous musician. You may know, just like J. Krishnamurti, some other master known as U.G. Krishnamurti. The U.G. Krishnamurti used to stay with the musician in his house. And the musician always want to get enlightenment. He asked the U.G. Krishnamurti, give me the enlightenment, please give me the enlightenment. But the U.G. Krishnamurti simply told him, why do you want the enlightenment? What is the necessity of enlightenment? What is the necessity of enlightenment? Why do you demand enlightenment? What is the necessity for that? So in this way he talked like this. But here, the necessity for the enlightenment is because we are in turmoil. We are with so many miseries, so many problems. So with the so many problems, when we think only because of enlightenment alone, we can be free from all our problems. So that is the reason for the seeking of enlightenment. So the main reason behind the enlightenment is to get freedom from all our problems, all our struggles. That is the reason for enlightenment. And here, you may know Ramana Maharishi. There are many disciples to Ramana Maharishi. And during the lifetime of Ramana Maharishi, many disciples asked question to Ramana Maharishi, "We are in trouble. We are in sorrow. We cannot solve our problems. Each and every time we are struggling with many problems. Our mind is not in good condition. Please help us." But Ramana Maharishi simply says, you are taking yourself to be the body. So, if you think, if you take yourself to be the body, if you take yourself to the physical body, the physical body will always have many kind of problems. So, if you take yourself to be the body, naturally you will be in the problems. Because there are many ailments in the body. There are many problems in the body. And in the same way, you take yourself to be the mind. If you take yourself to be the mind, then you cannot avoid problem. Because the mind will have many problems. The mind will have sorrow, the mind will have fear, many things will be in the mind. So if you think you are made up of mind, if you are made up of body, then it is inevitable for yourself to be free from, inevitable for yourself to be in the problem. So, but your real nature is not the body. Your real nature is not the mind. Your real nature is Atman, the soul. That is your real nature. If you understand, if you have the Atma Sakshatkar, that your original nature is the Atman itself and you are not the body, you are not the mind, then only you can be free from everything. Because Atma will not have any problem. The Atma does not have any worries, fear. It is unaffected from anything. So, if you understand, if you realize that you are the Atman itself, that is the only way to get yourself free from all your struggle, all your problems. So you get Atma Sakshatkar. You know yourself to be the Atman. You realize yourself to be the Atman. That is the only way. Otherwise, you cannot escape from your problem, you cannot escape from your trouble. So that is the only answer. Not only Ramana Maharishi, the scriptures itself say the same thing. You have to find out you are the Atman. Unless you find out yourself to be the Atman, you cannot escape from the turmoils of the world. You cannot escape from the worries of the world. You cannot escape from the struggle of the world. So if anybody, as a passerby, one can pass and get the statements and go on his own way. But if you are serious, yes, I want to know myself, I want to know the real nature of myself, and they will inquire, how can I find myself to be the Atman? How can I get the Atma Sakshatkar? If you are serious, naturally you will be in a position to be seriously asking question, how can I understand, how can I realize, how can I get Atma Sakshatkar? After us alone, other problem will come. How can we feel I am Atma? Or you know, or you feel you are Atma? Can anybody feel Atma? For example, I see you all through my eyes. And you may hear me, my sounds. Our communication is possible only through our sensory organs. Can I feel the Atma through our sensory organs? It is the very scriptures, they are introducing the Atman, definitely says that we cannot feel the Atman through our sensory organs. And the other tool of ourselves, we can feel many things, we can understand many things through our mind. We are having pleasure, pain, sorrow, suffering even in the mind. We are having some feeling, we are having some sensation through our mind. So can we sense the Atma through our mind? It is not possible. So we cannot know the Atma through our sensory organs, through our mind. So it is said, Atma is beyond mind and beyond the sensory organs. Then how can we understand, how can we feel the Atma? But they told, if you feel the Atma alone, then only you can be free from all your problems. But it is impossible to feel Atma because it is not within our reach. If it is perceivable through our senses, we can perceive it. If it is perceivable through our mind, we can perceive it. But it is within our capacity. If it is within our, if it is not within our capacity, how can we perceive it? But they put a condition that unless you know you are the Atman, unless you feel you are the Atman, you cannot be free from any problem. But how can we tell, how can we feel it and how can we know it? How can we solve the problem? And if you ask the scriptures, is there any way to realize the Atman? Is there any way to feel the Atman? Is there any way to know the Atman? And the scripture says a way. The scriptures gives a way how to know the Atman, how to feel the Atman. The scriptures, the Upanishads say, know the Atman through Atman itself. Feel the Atman through Atman itself. How is it possible? We do not know whether Atman is there or not. The scriptures alone say Atman is there. You are not the body, you are not the mind. Your real nature is Atman itself. But we do not know we are Atman. The scriptures alone say we are Atman. But we do not know. They simply say, you know Atman through Atman. How can it is possible? For example, one of our family member, for example, our brother is gone away to some other place and he has not returned home for several days. We inquired about him here and there. There is no result. For several days he has not returned. So there is no response from him, and at last we complained the details to a police station and request them to find out the missing person. And the police inspector asked us, I will try your best to secure the missing person. Please give some details. What is the last place the missing person has gone? Anybody knows the last place the missing person has gone? The inspector asked. Is there anybody knows what is the last place the missing person has visited last? We told the inspector only one person will have the knowledge about the last place the missing person visited. The inspector asked, who is that person? That himself is the missing person. So, if you say like this, what will happen? So, in this way, they place us a thing, place us a solution. If you know you are the Atman, if you realize you are the Atman, everything will be solved. But whenever we are trying, I am ready to realize Atman, I am ready to find out the Atman, please show me the way. Then they simply say, Atman alone will know the Atman, you cannot know. Then what is the meaning of that? But the scripture says like that. But we cannot ask the scriptures, why you are saying like this? But at the same time, if anybody say, if you or myself say like this, we will question. If you say like this, I will question you. If I say like this, you may question me. What you are saying? Why you are saying like this? So in this way, when Ramana Maharishi told the same thing, unless you got Atma Sakshatkar, unless you get the realization of Atma that you are, unless you find out you are the Atma itself, you cannot be free from Atma, you cannot be free from the problems of the world. The disciple asked some clarification from Ramana Maharishi. Can we understand, can we perceive the Atma through senses? Ramana Maharishi also says it cannot be perceived through senses. Can we perceive through mind? So you cannot perceive the Atma through mind. Then how can we perceive the Atma? But the Ramana Maharshi did not say, you have to find out the Atma through Atma. He did not say like this. He said in a different way. There is no such thing as Atma Satchatkar. There is no such thing as Atma Darsan. We will say like this, but there is no such thing. He simply denied his earlier statement. Instead of that, he said another statement. If you are free from ignorance, it can be considered as the understanding of Atma. It can be considered as a realization of Atma Satchatkar. In the early instance, he used a positive statement as if he can show the Atman, you come here and I will show the Atma. In this way he lead us. But afterwards he used a negative standard. And if you are free from ignorance, it can be considered as Atma Satchatkar. If in the first instance itself, if you are free from ignorance, you can be free from every problem. That is a straight statement, but he did not use the straight statement. As he draw everybody as if he can show the Atman itself. But now he denied his own statement and he refused his positive way, and he simply says, if you free from ignorance, everything is over, every problem is solved. So what is the meaning? If you are free from ignorance, you can be free from all problems. So what is the meaning? That means, if you are enlightened, you can be free from your problems. A child can say like this, if you are enlightened, you can be free from your problem. A child can say like this. For example, if you are having so many problems in your mind, if you ask a person, how can I free from my problem? And the other person will ask you, told you, if you get enlightenment, you will be free from the problem. But what is the meaning of that? You may simply say it like that, but what is the use of that? Is it easy to get enlightenment? Can we solve it for a solution? Can you recommend the enlightenment to solve this ordinary problem? But that is why they are, indirect way, they are driving us to a point where we cannot understand anything, we cannot proceed further. They place us in a place where we cannot confuse, we have to get the confusion. But that is a fact that is going on everywhere. We do not know what is enlightenment, what is Atma. Then they lead us to a certain point and they withdraw from their direction. They lead us as if they themselves can show us the way. But in the middle way, they go away and I cannot go further. You find your own path and I cannot help. So that is happening everywhere. So now, what is the problem? What is the case? In the case of Ramana Maharshi himself, got the enlightenment. There is no doubt about his enlightenment. He is enlightened. He is liberated. There is no doubt about it. He got enlightenment at his age of 16. At the time of his enlightenment, he is a student. He did not know anything about the spiritual world. He did not do any meditation practice, any yoga practices. He is just like the other children, a school boy. One day he got a fear of death. He do not know how to face the fear of death. He simply accept the fear of death and he got enlightened. He did not know what has happened to him, but he got enlightened. He did not know how he got the enlightenment. He did not know the science of enlightenment. But there is no doubt he got enlightened. There is no doubt about it. But some secret is there. Some science is there. But if you trace the history of many saints, abruptly many persons may got enlightenment. But we cannot know the details of enlightenment. So if you want to get some details of enlightenment, we have to rely upon some fact which is suitable to be traced, possible to be traced. So, in that case, if you take the case of Gautama Buddha, to a certain level, we can trace the journey of him, how he has got enlightenment. We can trace a certain level. He has not got the enlightenment all on a sudden, just like the Ramana Maharishi got. He has practiced in many ways. You may know about the life of Gautama Buddha. He also tried to get himself free from the struggles of the world, struggles of the mind, problems of the mind. He want to get some solution for his problem. He want a salvation, he want a relief for his all the problems of the mind. For that, he selected the yogic path, the spiritual path. And he got two gurus. And the two gurus give him many ways of practice. And Buddha also accepted the ways and he practiced many meditation, many yoga practices. We all know what is meditation, what is the yoga practices, because it is very common to all. There are many school of yogi practices and we may practice many things. In this way, Buddha also did many practices. So if we do meditation, our mind will be changed in a different dimension. For example, if you are a short-tempered person, if you do meditation for one hour, after the end of the meditation, your mind will be alright. Your mind will be very quiet. Even though if you are a short-tempered person, after the end of the meditation, if anybody teased you to get irritated, you will not be irritated. You will be very calm and quiet. But whether it will solve our problem for all, but our problems will be waiting as if the waiters waiting, the doctors are waiting behind in front of our house. So the energy field created by meditation will end within a short time. For example, if we put some key to a toy, the toy will dance and sing and go, run here and there. After the key is over, the toy will fall. So that is the nature of meditation. That is the nature of the yogic practices. And Buddha, when did such kind of meditation, for the time being he is alright. For afterwards, the old thing came again, the old turmoil, old problems come again and again. So he had to once again, he entered into meditation and established himself and created some energy field. He thought, because of some little kind of meditation, I can be keep myself with some good stage for a certain period. If I do meditation for a longer period, I can maintain myself, I can maintain my mind, I can maintain the energy field forever. He thought like that. And he practiced very seriously. He practiced all these yogi practices and meditation in a serious way. He more and more is serious. And then the result of his serious practice made him unhealthy. His body got many physical problems. He got many physical problems. So he cannot proceed further. But at the same time he got a vexed condition. He got a desperate condition. Because if he feel he was failed in his career. So whatever possible way he tried. But wherever he go, as if it comes and he got away from the energy field. The energy field came and gone away without his knowledge. So he do not know what to do, how to proceed further. So he sat up under a tree without not knowing anything how to proceed further. He felt himself to be a desperate, a dejected mood. He felt himself to be a failure. And he sat under a tree, not knowing to do anything. For example, a king is going to a war with many soldiers, many army. And during the war, he lost all his army, all his weapons, and stand alone without any weapon. How will he feel? So in this way, Buddha finds himself in a failure without not knowing anything. He sat under a tree in a dejected condition, in a desperate mood, not to do anything. At that time, he got the solution without doing anything. He is surprised. So previously he has got many things. He has not many deeds, but now he has not doing anything. He has not done anything. Without doing anything, he got the result. He got the salvation. He is surprised. He wondered, how is it possible? But what has happened is real. It is not false. What has happened is real. He is unable to understand what has happened. So he looked into himself, what has happened to him. And he told, there is a state of mind known as Nirvana. Nirvana. He is known as the Nirvana state. And there is a state of Nirvana in our mind. And I have not created the Nirvana state. It is already there. I have found out the Nirvana state within my mind. And the Nirvana state is not my own. It is for everybody. Everybody is having the Nirvana state in their own mind. But here, fortunately, I find out the Nirvana state within my mind. If whoever find out the Nirvana state within their own mind, they can be liberated, they can be enlightened. So here, what he has found out? What is the Nirvana state? If it is there within ourselves, we might have felt already, but we have not felt it. So what is the state of Nirvana? Is there anything in the name of Nirvana state? What is the state? But here, every masters, every saints find out the Nirvana state in their own way. But Buddha named it in the name of Nirvana state. The other person name it as liberation, mukti, moksha. They name it in a different way. Our scriptures defined it in mukti or moksha or liberation, awakening. But the matter is same. The subject is same. So what is that? And if you understand what is happening here in the name of the liberation, the enlightenment, some other incident is there. And in a court of a king, a saint has visited the court of a king. And the king asked his problem to the saint. I have many problems. Please solve my problems. As if the disciple asked the master Ramana Maharishi, the king also asked the saint to solve his problem. But this saint did not say like Ramana Maharishi, please understand yourself to be the Atma. He did not say like this. Instead of that, he told in a different way. You hand over all your problems to me and I will solve the problem. He simply said like this. But the king told him, Swami, the problem is not here. If it is outside, I can hand it over to you. But the problem is within my mind. How can I hand it over to you? And the saint says, so it doesn't matter. If it is in your mind, you need not hand it over to me. But you do one thing. If it is in your mind, it has to be located, it has to be situated in some other place, in some place of your mind. See, you please find out the and locate the place where the problems are staying. And the king look into himself, look into his mind and search where the problems are staying. What is the location, what is the place where all our problems are staying? And he told the saint, if I look into my mind, I did not find anything. It is pure darkness, there is nothing there. Now the saint asked, you yourself have told me that you have problems. Now yourself tell there is no problem. So what is the reality, whether problem is there or not? So in the name of problem, in the name of solving our problems, we are searching enlightenment, we are searching liberation. The basic problem is that we have to be free from our problems. But whether the problem is existing or not, now the problem is that whether there is a problem or not is the problem. Not the enlightenment or liberation is not a problem. Whether there is any problem or not. Are we trying to solve the real problem or unreal problem? In imaginary problem. Is there really a problem or not? But here, we feel we have a problem, we are struggling, the struggle is there, our pain is there. If you are not painful, if you do not have any fear, if you do not have any sorrow, we will not seek anything. But we feel something is there. And we want to be free from that. So how to be free from that? Is there really a problem or not? What we have to do? And in one of my meeting session, one gentleman asked a question. I have a problem. I cannot control my anger. It is very easy for me to get angry, but it is very hard. It is very difficult for me to control my anger. Please show some method, some technique to control my anger. So I approached the question in a humorous way. You see, it is difficult for yourself to control anger. It is not only for your case. In my case also, it is very difficult for me to control my anger. So I cannot show you the way how to control the anger. But at the same time, you have told me two statements. The one statement is that getting angry is very easy. Controlling anger is very difficult. In the second statement with related to controlling anger, we are both in the same boat. It is difficult for me how to control anger, you also find it difficult to control anger. We are both same. There is no difference between both you and me. But please explain your first statement. I am not agree with your first statement. It is very easy to get angry. You are saying that it is very easy to get angry. So if it is easy to get angry, please show me to keep yourself in an angry mood from morning till evening. So if it is easy for you, you can very easily keep yourself in a state of angry from morning till evening. If it is difficult, it is not possible. But you say it is very easy to get angry and show me and keep yourself in an angry state from morning till evening. So here the problem is, unknowingly or knowingly, we are having some intention that as if we can control our emotion. We can tackle our emotion, we can keep all our emotion within ourselves, within our hand. The problem is that how to tackle our emotions, that is the real problem. And the enlightened masters alone know the technique how to deal with the emotions. So we approach the enlightened master how to deal with the emotions and please help us to deal with our emotions. And really, the enlightened masters got the technique how to deal with the emotions. All enlightened masters succeeded in their career. Buddha succeeded, Ramana Maharishi succeeded, everybody succeeded, everybody got success. How they got success? We have described, we have analyzed the ways of the Buddha. How did he have got the enlightenment? What has happened to Buddha? Ramana Maharishi simply says, you get liberated, you get relieved from the ignorance of yourself. If you are liberated from your ignorance, if you are free from ignorance, everything will be solved. So what is the meaning of that? Who is having ignorance? Who is having enlightenment? Is it our, whether ignorance is in our mind, or is it in the Atman itself? Whether the Atman got ignorance, or our mind is in ignorance. We all know ignorance is only in our mind. Because we do not know anything about the Atman, so we cannot attach the ignorance to Atman. We do not know even Atman itself. We know our mind. So, all our problems are only in the mind. The understanding is in our mind. The ignorance is in our mind. The enlightenment is in our mind. The liberation is in our mind. So the problem is that it's a psychological problem. But we make it in a complicated way. We attach some mystical name. Enlightenment, liberation. We attach some mystical name. By attaching some mystical name, we may feel some pleasure out of that. But at the same time, we got confusion. We may got enlightened. We may got liberated. By giving a good name, some divine name, we may feel pride of that. But doesn't matter. But it is not. It is, but everything is only a psychological matter. Everything is related to the mind. But here, if we know what is the functioning of the mind, we can understand the science of enlightenment. What is the working state of the enlightenment? But there are many mystical words, many mystical sayings related to the enlightenment and liberation. One day I got a phone from USA, some Tamilian, he is living at USA, he has had some conversation with me, he told me something. The enlightenment and liberation is a very dangerous thing. He told me, enlightenment is a very dangerous thing. If anybody got the enlightenment above the years of 40, he will be destroyed. Because whenever one got the enlightenment, it will enter our mind, enter our body, just like a thunderbolt. So we cannot withstand the power of the enlightenment. He told me like that. So I simply told him, you may put some antenna so they can avoid the bad effect of this thunder. So simply make a joke. So what is enlightenment? But it is very simple. If you understand what is the function of mind, we can very easily understand what is enlightenment. But we do not know what is the Atman. But we know a little bit of our mind. And there are many complicated theories about mind. Conscious mind, subconscious mind, deeper conscious mind, super conscious mind, supraconscious. There are many descriptions of mind. But we do not make it in a psychological game. We can approach our mind as a common man. As a layman, we can divide our mind into two ways. The one is intellect, the other one is emotion. That is a common classification. It is enough. We need not complicate it in giving it very various names, various details. We know what is intellect. Because we have many knowledge about many things. One may study medicine, or engineering and get some qualification of through his knowledge. That is intellect. Our intellectual knowledge, our intellect is known as the intellect part of our mind. So with the help of our intellect alone, we are doing everything. If you do not have the intellect, we cannot function. After the end of the meeting, you have to return your home. If your intellect is not functioning, you cannot return home. So, intellect is a major part of our mind. It is very necessary. It is inevitable. We know all what is intellect, what is the role of intellect. The other part of our mind is the emotions. That is the complicated part of the mind. We all want to be happy, we all want to be in peace, we want to have without any tension, we want to be without any tension. But the emotion will not hear our ways, hear our sounds, hear our order. It will come as if it likes. We may think we want to be free without fear, but fear will come. We want to be without any tension, but tension will come. We may be interested upon a happiness, but happiness will not come. But instead of that, some sorrow will come. So it is not in our hand. So if our emotional part is under our control, we can take all our problems are solved. So the real problem is related to the emotions. So the enlightened masters alone understand how to deal with our emotions. That alone is the real question, that alone is the real problem, not only of the spiritual world, but also to the entire world. If one is able to free from the emotions, if one is having the control over the emotion, the total problem will be solved. So that is the question. That is the real problem. So, our enlightenment, liberation, all center around this nucleus of how to deal with our emotions. So, how to deal with our emotion, how to get free from our emotion, that is a deciding factor related to the enlightenment liberation. So, here, we all got the details of the enlightenment of masters, Ramana Maharishi, Buddha. There are many masters. What they happened? What happened to them? How they got enlightenment? How they got the Nirvana state? If it is there, then why we are not free from the emotions, the problem of emotions? If the liberation is already with us, then we are having some struggle with the emotions, and they have solved the problem. For example, we have shared there are many persons having some sorrow for years together, and they are struggling with many sorrows and problems. If anybody got some emotion, just like fear, anger, sorrow, what is the life duration of a emotion? For example, if one has got sorrow, how long the sorrow will exist? What is the time duration? What is the life duration of an emotion? How long it will exist? Whether it will exist for 1 hour, 2 hours, 1 month, 2 months, or a year together. Here, we need not ask the life duration of an emotion, to an enlightened person. Even a scientist or an ordinary person will say, what is the life duration of an emotion? All over the life duration of an emotion is only a very fraction of a second. Not more than a fraction of a second, an emotion cannot exist. Just like an explosion, all emotion comes just like an explosion and explode and it disappears. Only at the time of disappearance alone, we recognize the emotion itself. Even before the recognition of the emotion, it disappeared. But we think it is existing forever. We mistakenly think that we are having a continuous experience. We are having the continuous feeling of some emotion. It is a mistaken identity. For example, in a rainy season, we may have the knowledge of the thunder, the lightning and thunder. A flashlight may come. After a few seconds, you may have the noise of the thunder. Nobody will be afraid of the flashlight. Everybody will be afraid of the thunder noise, as if it will fall upon their head. But whoever hears the noise of the thunder will never fall upon his head, because it is already over. The thunder is over at the time of flashlight itself. If it has to fall upon our head, it has to fall upon during the flashlight of itself. But it is a later effect of the thunder, later effect of the lightning. So when we hear the thunder noise, there is no thunder at all. But we think something is there. So in this way, each and every emotions are going away, coming and going, disappearing, just like an explosion. We recognize the emotion only after the disappearance of the emotion. But we behave as if it is existing. That is why we are giving life to the emotion. Otherwise, all the emotions will come and disappear. All emotions are coming and going just like a living river. No water will stay. Everything is passing away. Everything is going away. Everything is running away. Everything is moving. Nothing is standing. Nothing is staying. There is no stagnation. But we are mistakenly done a mistake, as if we have to solve something. We have to enter. We have to deal something. As if we have some work there, we are entering there. For example, some water is there in a bowl. The water is very still. If you place your finger on the surface of the water, some round ripple will form. Some wave-like ripple will form at the surface of the water. What we have to do to settle down the wave? Shall we brush away the wave through our hand? If we brush away the wave through our hand, another wave will form. So in this way, we are renewing our emotions. We are renewing our problem. If you do not do anything, everything will be solved on its own way. 2 or 3 years back, I had been to Malaysia, where I found I have to wash my hands in a wash basin. And the wall is a pressing type, the tap is a pressing type tap. Just like India, the tap is just like pressing type. When I here also, we are having the pressing type tap, where you have to press the tap in the one hand and wash the other hand. And when we give up the pressing, and the water will stop. So here also, I press the tap in one hand and wash my other hand. And when I give up the pressing, normally we have the water will stop. But here, the water did not stop. So I suspect some mistake in the spring action of the valve, the valve of the tap. So I adjust the tap so that the problem may be solved. But the water hill did not stop. So I asked the other person, I do not know how to stop the water, please help me. But the person, I asked them, he go away, you please come, you need not work. you come along with me, he say like that. But I got so doubt, why is he saying like that? But I tried in several times as if to set right the tap. But no benefit. So I give up the effort and I also move away from that. When I move away from that, the water stopped itself. But now this kind of tap is now available in India itself. So it is designed like that. Whenever you touch the tap, the water will come. Then after you can wash the hand, you need not stop the water. It will stop on its own. But here, our problem is in this way. But we are thinking that we have to stop our problem. We want to take the emotions in our hand. So taking the emotion in our hand, it alone is a problem. If you do not take the emotions in our hand, everything will be solved on its own. So this real finding is related to the emotion is known as enlightenment. So enlightenment is not a mystical one. It is some intellectual one. You have to understand, you have no work there. It is only related, the enlightenment is related to the intellectual matter. But the liberation is not so. Liberation is not intellectual. Liberation is the other thing. Liberation is related to the emotional thing. Because in the word of liberation also, we are also attaching some mystical meaning. But it is not a mystical one. The appearance and disappearance of our emotion is the liberation. So that what is coming and that is going on, what is appearing, what is, that is disappearing, it is also just like a moving river, just like a flowing river. That is the natural state of our mind. The very natural state of our mind is in the liberation. We need not get liberation. Our work is over with the enlightenment. If we understand there is no work on our part, that is enlightenment. If you got enlightenment, if you understand there is no work on our part, everything is over. Everything is already there. The liberation is already there. Our mind is already in liberation. We need not create liberation. We cannot create liberation. Liberation is already there. But we are unnecessarily interfering with the liberation. For example, some water is flowing. In the flowing water, if you put our hand across the flowing water, what will happen? We may put our hand either to stop the flow or to encourage the flow. So whatever you do, in whatever way you put the hand across the flowing water, the water will circle around your hand. So if the circle is happening in a clockwise, if you rotate your hand in the anti-clockwise, the world will not go. So upwards. Our sufficient time will be given. So if you rotate your hand in a anti-clockwise, the world will not go. So if you remove the hand, the world will disappear. So the putting our hand there in the natural flowing of our emotion, that alone creates the problem. So here we have to understand there is no way for ourselves. There is no work for ourselves. That is happening in all the saints. All the masters got the same thing, that their incapability to do anything. If you want to do something, it is yoga practices. Some practices you can do something, thereby you can get some emotions, some vibrations, some energy field. You can create. But the energy field will lost for time being, or it will disappear. So that is the purpose of the yoga practices and other things. But liberation and enlightenment is different. Then the understanding that we have no work, that is enlightenment. And when we understand like this, we allow the mind to function in a natural way. When our mind is functioning in a natural way, that is liberation. But we are not allowing our mind to function in a natural way. We are interfering it. So we have to stop our interference. Only because of our understanding, only because of enlightenment alone, we can stop our interference. So if we stop our interference, our matter is over. So everything will be solved. You may hear the life history of Jai Krishnamurti. He was expected to be the world teacher. and many special training was given to him to equip himself. He got many state of experience through meditation practices. He got samadhi state, transcendental state, astral travel, many mystical experiences. But in spite of all those things, he did not get the enlightenment. He waiting for the enlightenment. At that time, his own brother got some sickness. Everybody prayed for the relief of the brother. But in spite of all the prayers and the assurance of some deities, his brother died. He cannot accept the sorrow. Jai Krishnamurti cannot accept the sorrow of the death of his brother. If he want to be free from sorrow, he can simply go to the samadhi state, he can be free from sorrow. But he did not try that. He simply accept the sorrow. He locked himself in a room. He keep himself with the sorrow. And he returned from the room as an enlightened person. So what has happened? What if you accept his mind, if anybody accepts the functioning of his mind, then you can find the liberated state of your mind. But whenever you are trying to control your mind, then you are disturbing the liberation. So the understanding that we have no work with the functioning of our mind, that is understanding, that is the enlightenment. But in the case of Aravinda, he also faced such kind of thing. He has done many spiritual practices, many yogic practices, and got many experiences, many mystical experiences. But he did not get enlightenment. One day he was bored with these mystical experiences and put down everything. And he did not do anything, and he himself without doing anything for 1 year. Not doing anything, no practice, no meditation techniques. He put down everything and keep himself without doing anything for 1 year. Suddenly he got a change. He did not know what has happened to him because he did not do anything. Without doing anything, how it is possible to have a change like this? He unable to understand. During that period he got a guru. So he rushed to his guru and asked him, "I have not done anything for years together. I am not doing any practice. I simply give up everything. But suddenly I got a change. What has happened? Have you blessed me anything with such kind of great experience? Have you given me any blessings like that to have the change like this?" He asked his guru. And his guru inquired him what has happened to him. And after he is told, what you have had, I myself have not got. You have got what I have not yet got. So how can I bless such a thing what I don't have? So there is a statement of the guru. So Aravinda simply said, so the divine power has given me the blessings. He is told like this. But it is a science. If you do not do anything, if you do not try to control your mind, if you give total freedom to your mind, everything will be natural. If you squeeze your mind, if you design your mind, if you torture your mind, some results will be there. But it is temporary, it is problem. Whether some good thing may happen or bad thing may happen, that is not the good, correct thing. So if you have given total freedom to your mind, if you do not do anything related to the mind, everything will be okay. So the natural functioning of our mind is the liberation of ours. And for that we have to understand, we have no work. So that alone is in our hand. We have to understand we have no work. To that extent we can work, we can inquire, we can... For that, if it is enough, from the beginning, we have narrated a story of the king Janaka. What has happened? He has put his one leg on the one spot of the saddle. Before he put the other leg on the other saddle, the Ashokara disappeared. So what happened? In the meantime, Janaka got enlightened. What happened to him? He do not know what to do. So he was placed in a position what to do. He was placed in a position not to do anything, because he has to follow the disciple, follow the guru. But the guru disappeared without giving any command. He gave the command only to put the leg on the one saddle alone. But he has not given any other command further. So he was in a position not to follow anything. So what to do? So when you are not doing anything for yourself, but at the same time your mind will not stop. The mind will function on its own. Even though you are not functioning, the mind will function on its own. So indirectly he gives a way to the natural functioning of our mind. So the natural functioning of the mind is the liberation. So in an indirect way, the Ashokara give a way to find the natural functioning of his mind.